Joel, come on up here, please.
Okay.
This is our last Sunday that we're going to have you with us. And you have meant an awful lot to this church. You've done a lot to build a program for the youth. You've connected with some of them and you stay in touch with them. And this church can't thank you enough. We are truly going to miss you, your wife, and your children. And we wish nothing but the very, very best for you. As a way of saying thank you, we want to give you this gift. And it's from every member of the congregation that participated in this. You have meant a lot. And we know that God's got great and wonderful plans for you, and we're excited for you about that. We will miss you, and we love you and your family, but we wish you the very, very best in all that you do.
Thank you.
Would you like to say something to the congregation?
I'm going to miss each and every one of you. I love y'all so much. And Miss Latifia, it's even with the quarantine, it's hard. And it's hard for us not to see your faces. And I just appreciate this, and I thank you, and I love each and every, we love each and every one of you, and I wish I could give you a hug, but the government says I can't. So, but I do love you. Thank you.
Okay. Can we have a prayer?
Sure, yes.
Gracious and loving God, we know that your plan for Joel is beyond our imagination. We thank you, Lord, for giving this church the opportunity to get to know Joel and to see his talents, to see him grow within your word and to follow your will. We know, Lord, that wherever you lead him, he will accept that graciously. Thank you, Lord, for giving Quail Hollow an opportunity to be included in Joel's life and us in him. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Good morning. Okay. Let me welcome you once again to our online worship service at Quail Hollow Presbyterian Church. We are happy that you decided to join us on this special day, this Palm Sunday, and we hope that our service will be meaningful and joyful. If you would like more information about our church, about worshiping opportunities, please visit our website or call the church office. You can find most of that information on our website, email, phone numbers, and so on. I would like to thank the many church members who have helped make this special worship service possible, especially when we are limited in how many people can gather at one time. And let me just remind you that we must be diligent in our efforts of maintaining proper distance between one another. And if we have to go out, make sure you maintain that minimum distance of 6 feet. Please wash your hands and just take every precaution. We appreciate the fact that many of you want to stay current in your giving. You may do so on our website or through the U.S. Postal Service. If you have not used the online link before for your gifts, call us and we'll be happy to walk you through it. And just remember that the Church of Jesus Christ thanks you for your gracious giving. Now hear these words. The psalmist asked, "How can we sing the Lord's song in a strange land?" That is from 137 verse 4. We wonder how we're going to celebrate this Palm Sunday, how we can follow Jesus on the path to the cross in this time when we are in exile. We are in exile from our safe and comfortable churches, our special pews that we occupy, the friends that we sit next to. We are in exile from one another. But we celebrate this Palm Sunday by worshiping online, knowing that many members, guests, and friends have tuned in. And then we follow Jesus by reading his word. We follow Jesus through prayer. We follow Jesus by reaching out to a friend with a kind word, sending a handwritten note or a phone call. And most important, by knowing that God is in our life and present always. So let us pray together. Holy God, you reveal the truth about your people and the ways of the world in the suffering of the Son and his steadfast love. Show us again the image of humility you desire for us, and teach us obedience so that self-emptying may be our pathway through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you.
Let us gather for the call to worship. Awake to the day of triumph for our Savior. Give thanks for this day that leads to the cross. Come with branches, hosannas, and song. Fill the air with welcome to the Lord. Blessed be the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Let us gather for the call to confession. Let us face this day of palms and Jesus' passion with honesty, confessing our sin before God. Let us pray. Holy God, sure of your faithfulness, even in your dying, comforted by your compassion toward your people in every age, we beg your mercy for our imperfect gratitude. We have looked to you for paltry favors when you have given everything. We have withheld from your people, our neighbors, and from your creation, our earth, the care and tending they desire. We have rejected the cornerstone you sent to build a people of righteousness, even here today. Forgive our failings. Heal what we have broken, nurture what we have neglected, and lead us to your vision, so that we may know the peace of wholeness in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Your God has come to you, humble in the form of a slave, to free you from the weight of sin and death. Jesus' obedient suffering has released you. Your sins are forgiven by the one who is exalted. Praise God through Christ our Savior. Thank you. God's peace is from everlasting to everlasting. Through Christ, God's peace becomes our gift to one another. Let us offer that gift to each other. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Children, please gather around the device your parents are watching because it's time for the children's message. Today is Palm Sunday, when we celebrate Jesus riding into town while all of the people celebrated him as a king by waving palm branches. We don't have any palm branches today, and since we're not together, we're going to use the palm of our hand. So everybody wave to the camera and pretend you're waving to Jesus as he rides into town. This is the start of Holy Week. Holy Week starts with Jesus riding into town as king today. By Thursday, Jesus is washing the feet of his disciples and celebrating the Last Supper. Then he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. There he gets arrested. The next day, he's actually put to death on the cross. But by next Sunday, Jesus will rise from the dead and overcome the cross, saving us from our sins. That's quite an emotional week. A lot of ups and downs, kind of like what you might be experiencing right now with what's going on around the world. It's difficult sometimes when you can't play with your friends, you're not going to school, you can't come to church and do other things. But what Jesus did during his emotional week is he always prayed to God. He knew that God was with him no matter what. He prayed as he was riding into town. He prayed before the Last Supper. He prayed in the garden. He prayed even while he was dying on the cross. And then he prayed when he appeared to the disciples after coming back from the dead. So, I want you to remember that if you get scared, if you get worried, it's okay. But God is always with you. And you need to remember to pray and thank God for being with you and pray that he will help you get through what's going on right now. I want you to repeat after me and say this prayer. Jesus, sometimes we are scared or don't know what's going on, but we know you are always with us no matter what. Thank you for being with us. Now, we don't have children's church because we're not together. So here's what I want you to do while your parents watch the rest of the church service. Go find a quiet place where you live and pray just for a few minutes. Thank God and thank him for all the things and blessings he has given you. And during this Holy Week, I want you to go to that quiet place every day and pray for just a minute or two. All right, have a good week.
Thank you. Let your word, O God, break through our hearts this day, through the power of the Holy Spirit, that we may enter into the coming Holy Week with the same mind that was in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Psalm 118, verses 1 and 2. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever.
Psalm 118, verses 19 through 29. Open for me the gates of righteous. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this very day. Let us rejoice today and be glad. Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. For the house of the Lord, we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us. With bows in hand, join in the festal procession up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever.
The scripture text that I have chosen this morning is Matthew 21, 1 through 11. It is a text that we hear every Palm Sunday in one form or another. This one happens to be from Matthew. So listen to the word of the Lord for us this morning. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this: the Lord needs them, and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road. Others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When he entered into Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Let your word, O Lord, break open our hearts this day through the power of the Holy Spirit, that we may enter into the coming Holy Week with the same mind that was in Christ Jesus. Amen. History tells us that Jesus' ministry took place during a 3-year period, from his baptism to crucifixion, roughly 1,000 days. But the most important part of his ministry took place during the last 7 days of his life. To emphasize this point, Matthew devotes 30% of his gospel to this last week of Jesus' life. Mark devotes 40%, Luke 20, and John almost 50%. Everything Jesus had done up to his final week was pointing towards Jerusalem. His teaching, the loving compassion that he shown towards others, the healing, and of course, raising ones from the dead. As Jesus begins the last week of his life, he enters Jerusalem, a city that was perceived to be the house of God. but was also the epicenter of the opposition to God's Son. This was during a week-long celebration of the Passover, when over 200,000 people would come to the holy city. They came to celebrate Israel's defining history, remembering how God had delivered them from slavery. We know this story well. In Matthew, Jesus sends two disciples to bring him a donkey and a colt, which he rides into the city. But let me ask you, does this statement, a donkey and a colt, sound something like you might hear in a circus act? Jesus riding both of them into town with one foot on the donkey and one foot on the colt? In Matthew's text, Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, Matthew referred to the Hebrew scripture from Zechariah. In chapter 9, verse 9, from Zechariah we read, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you, triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the fold of a donkey." O. Wesley Allen Jr., in his commentary, refers to this as a fulfillment notice, quoting scripture to be as authentic as possible. He continues when he says, "This type of writing is also known as poetic parallelism, used in ancient Hebraic poetry. The poet repeats something with an artful variation, like in this text, mounted on a donkey and a colt." So here's the point. Does this understanding of poetic parallelism help you understand that you cannot always interpret Scripture literally? Now back to our text. We know that riding a donkey was a richly symbolic act going back to King David. But consider this as well. If you're going to ride an animal in a rocky and hilly terrain like that of Palestine, the donkey would be your best choice, because it is a sure-footed animal. So Jesus enters Jerusalem, the great city of kings, the holy city, but also the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. This is Jesus' first time in the holy city. And those with him are spreading their cloaks on the road while others are witnessing their act. They are busily cutting branches and spreading them before Jesus. The crowd grows and they are shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" Now, by the crowd shouting, "Hosanna," they are actually asking Jesus to, quote, save us. See, the crowd fully expected Jesus to be that warrior king and defeat the Roman overlords and to fight for the underdogs. Jesus' entrance into the city is so different than those of the corrupt and egocentric political rulers. Jesus comes in humility, not flaunting power or threatening violence, just offering peace and compassion. Jesus sits atop a donkey like Solomon did when he entered Jerusalem, while Herod comes into town with great fanfare. Our text tells us the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this Jesus and what's all this fuss about?" The crowd identifies him as a prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. Jesus comes to the city to fulfill God's plan, not to magnify himself or to overturn Roman rule. Now, there were two other royal processions entering Jerusalem that day. Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor from Judea, entered with over 1,000 Roman soldiers in chariots and on horseback. Others were on foot with their weapons and regalia. His entrance is a display of power and force designed to suppress any thoughts of rebellion. Remember, this festival was to celebrate the Jews' freedom from an oppressive ruler like Pilate had become. Pilate wanted to make sure that no one was thinking about liberation. So his entrance with soldiers and weapons was to remind the people that he was in control. The other procession that day was that of King Herod, who entered with his own show of force, royal soldiers, chariots, and horses. Herod, too, understood how the show of force could weaken the spirit of the people. Many thought that one day Herod would be the ruler of Rome. So his supporters lined the streets as he entered, cheering him into the city. Now, two of the three entering Jerusalem in parades that day were iron-fisted men, known for their cruelty and death to maintain their own power, to maintain the status quo. One writer describes Jesus' entry into Jerusalem as the first nonviolent demonstration. In our contemporary world, we too have many examples of leading a nonviolent demonstration. Martin Luther King led people on foot to Washington. Gandhi led his people on the Salt March in India. And then we have the demonstrators in Tiananmen Square in China. Not to mention the many other demonstrators that have happened in the last several years of demonstrations. These are just a few, and there are many more nonviolent demonstrations, all designed to bring attention to injustices and the need for change. Jesus' entry into the city was disrupting the status quo, was it not? The Roman authority figures wanted the people's attention, wanted them to focus on Rome and those who led Rome, not some dusty carpenter who associated with the lowly, the sick, and the oppressed. You know, every few years, we have a candidate running for political office who proudly states that he or she is running against the status quo. They promise things that we all want to hear, almost as boldly as promising a chicken in every pot. Sometimes they are successful, making small changes in a system that is hard to change. We know that changing the establishment can be done. It just takes patience and peaceful determination. Martin Luther King wrote this: "You can bomb our homes, you can threaten our children and hurt us, but we will wear you down by our capacity to suffer. And we will love you. We will love you until that day comes when finally we win you over. And when we do, we will have a double victory. For you will be changed and our world will be changed." End quote. Our call on this Palm Sunday is to peacefully challenge the status quo, just as Jesus did riding into Jerusalem. We, as Christian brothers and sisters, have been silent too long. When we witness injustice being done to another human being, we are to speak up against that injustice and hold those accountable for their actions. When we witness children and families going hungry, we need to speak up and address the problem. When we find individuals suffering from an illness or disease because they cannot afford adequate health care, we are called to challenge the reasons why. When we see people being mistreated because of their color, their nationality, or the religion that they practice, we need to get up and come to their aid. Friends, we are called Christians, and with that title comes responsibilities. And sometimes those responsibilities are a call to action, a call to peaceful and loving action that our Savior so perfectly showed the world. So as we begin Holy Week, we are blessed that we do not have to face a Pilate, a Herod, or an angry crowd that shouted, "Crucify him." But we are called to change, to have a personal reboot. So let us shout, "Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest." And let us become more Christ-like, showing greater humility to all and more compassion to our brothers and sisters. Let us let go of self and admit we are wrong and then ask for forgiveness. Jesus taught us this. But maybe the most important thing we can do this Holy Week is to leave our old self at the cross of Jesus and take up our new cross and follow Jesus. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, as we do each and every week, let us affirm our faith by saying together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born under the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From hence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Friends, let us now prepare our hearts and minds for prayer. Let us pray. Loving God, we are once again separated from our community of faith. Even though we are separated from others, Lord, we know that You have not changed, and You are with us even when we cannot gather in the Church of Jesus Christ. Therefore, Lord God, during this short period of separation, guide us in making a sanctuary where we are. Calm our spirits so that we can truly focus on Your presence. Open our hearts as only You can do, so we can feel Your peaceful and loving warmth as You remind us to be still and know that You are God. Help us to trust in Your promises and to turn to You when we are feeling weak and doubtful, alone and fearful. Help us, Lord, not to turn from You for the virus that is causing many of us to be ill and some to lose their lives. We pray that all those who are ill, Lord, will be touched by Your loving hand. It is by Your grace and Your love that they can experience Your peace and rest with a calm heart. For those who have lost loved ones and friends, we pray that they will find comfort turning to You. Lord, You created this precious and tender planet that we call home. We have not taken care of Your creation. We are a broken people, Lord, and we have broken our promises of care. Care for the earth we inhabit and care for the people of creation. Shake us, Lord. Help us to hear Your call. And then help us, Lord, to see the dangers that we continue to look past. We cannot leave our mess for others when our call is to care. And Lord, help us not to listen to the voices that encourage separation and hate, but to hear only the voices of love and forgiveness, voices that encourage justice, kindness, and humility. By hearing and following these voices, our moral compass will be restored and our hearts filled with loving grace. And when others look upon your disciples, they will see the joy and peace of Christ shining through. Now, Lord, let us pray as one, as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples by saying together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, we are called to support not only the people of God's creation, but the church that Jesus established. We do so by our gifts to the Lord. So on this Palm Sunday, let our hosannas to the one who brings liberation, grace, and unconditional love take form in our tithes and offerings. Thank you. us pray. God of all good gifts, we thank you for showing us how to care for each other. These gifts lead to a great feast for those who have no banquet set before them. May these gifts build shelter and places of prayer and worship for those who have none. Give us grateful hearts, O God, in the name of the one who came to draw all people to himself, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Friends, Jesus rode into Jerusalem with a humble heart. He didn't come to create or stir the people. He came following God's will. We, as Christian brothers and sisters, are called to follow God's will. So let us make this our call, and let us hear God in our hearts. Now may the Spirit of the Lord rest upon you, the word of the Lord live within you, and the glory of the Lord shine around you this day and always. Amen.